So good evening. Welcome to the International Peace Institute. I'm Maureen Quinn, Director of Programs. We're very pleased to partner tonight with the International Civil Society Action Network to discuss inclusive peacemaking, its challenges, and its opportunities. This is the second time that we've partnered with the International Civil Society Action Network, and under our series, our event series on women, peace, and security. So thanks all of you for being here with us tonight. And we are especially pleased to be holding this event during the annual Commission on the Status of Women. Now, several of my colleagues here at IPI are really the driving force behind this series. And I want to mention in particular tonight Marianne Feeney, who's not able to be with us. And then I also want to mention that we're very pleased, particularly around the topic tonight of inclusive peacemaking, because here at the International Peace Institute, we have started a new research program on this issue, and it's going to focus this year on women in mediation, and it's being led by my colleagues Marie O'Reilly and Andrea Ó Súilleabháin. And we're very glad tonight that Andrea Ó Súilleabháin is moderating our panel. So thank you all again very much for being here with us, and we look forward to a very interesting discussion and opportunity for questions and answers. So Andrea, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Quinn. thank you, thank you. Thanks to all of you for being here during a very busy week as well. We're here tonight to discuss women and civil society in peacemaking. Big decisions are made at the peace table, not only about bringing violence and conflict to an end, but also about shaping the future of society itself in countries emerging from conflict. But on average, despite UN commitments, guidelines, and 7 Security Council resolutions on women, peace, and security, only 7% of those at the peace table are women. And at the head of the table, only 2% of mediators are women. Tonight we ask, what effect does this have on the peace process itself and on the peace that follows? 42% of peace agreements fail within 5 years. Could this number be different if women and civil society enjoyed more meaningful inclusion in peace processes? Quantitative research on peace agreements signed between 1989 and 2004 says yes, that the inclusion of civil society reduces the risk of peace agreement failure by 64%. Here at IPI, we're researching the link between women's participation and the success of peace talks. We're asking how international mediators can help reset the peace table. And we're delighted tonight to be joined by such an experienced and global panel to explore these questions. Just to note, we have simultaneous translation available this evening, so when it's needed, you can use Channel 1 for English and Channel 2 for Arabic. You have the biographies of our speakers with you, so I'll just briefly introduce each one before their presentation. Our first speaker here is Samra Filipovic. She's the director. She's the director of the Agency for Gender Equality in Bosnia and Herzegovina, where women were largely left out of the Dayton Peace Agreement in 1995, but where they have worked very hard for an increased political role ever since. Samra, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So many questions and so many answers, I would say. But before I start, I would like to thanks to International Peace Institute to invite me and to give me possibilities to share my experience with you, to meet the old friend, and to introduce the new friend as well. So it's always great to be with the friends, with the same or similar energy in the room. It's something that I'm really grateful to our host. It's important to emphasize that the main goal of building any post-conflict society should be to build healthy interpersonal relationship that adorn respect and mutual respect. Women in war, torn Bosnia and Herzegovina, have undergone difficult times during 90s. As in every war, women and girls in Bosnia and Herzegovina were a specially vulnerable category, regardless of their roles: wife, mothers, breadwinners, part of the civil society, soldiers, social or political promoters of peace. Separate category represents women victims of war abuse, rape, humiliation, and persecution. And for sure you heard that firstly in Bosnia and Herzegovina, rape was used as the mean for genocide, as well as the in Bosnia and Herzegovina, the raped women were kept to deliver the children who are the results of rape. And it was really, really, they were big stories that I also heard from women who were witnesses during the war criminal process. And that kind of the stories, when that kind of the women's witnesses were something that you cannot forget very easily. It goes without saying that it had an influence on reconstruction peace building in Bosnia and Herzegovina. It wasn't easy to build and keep peace in condition of destroyed mental and physical health of women and men. Many women were left without their families. There was complete collapse of life's dignity and self-confidence. Women left without their husbands had to take of their families. The Dayton-Paris peace agreement ended the war and paved the way to peace and stability in B&H. At the same time, it created a complex state structure. Nevertheless, even in these conditions, women took active part and took over the responsibilities to build and keep still fragile peace in the country, peace established by Dayton Peace Agreement. In the country and the region torn with conflicts, initiative run by women and initiative in the area of the gender equality have created bridges and thus conditions for reconciliation and sustainable peace. Women were first to cross the borders between conflicted entities and ethnic divisions. And women's organization, or rather women's peace movement in Bosnia and Herzegovina, left a significant mark in reconciliation process. They provided shelter and psychological and social help to other women, and their advocacy resulted in adoption of relevant legal provision for women's rights and gender equality, as in the country as well as on international level. There were several published books in Bosnia and Herzegovina that contained the life stories of women peacemakers in B&H. They all emphasized the importance of reestablishing and fostering broken relationship among people, which is crucial to building peace, as between each other, but also on the social, institutional, and global level. Their stories show that they are not perfect women. They also can be wrong and scared, but the thing that sets these women apart was the strength to stand up straight and do something in order to help somebody else. Their deep faith that there is humanity in every man and that every human needs encouragement gave them strength to continue down the road to peace. That is what makes our women's story special. It was not easy to induce the changes that are results of four social, ethnic, political, and gender frameworks. So, in Bosnia and Herzegovina, no one side, we have female activists, women's peace movements, and on the other, we have women members of institutions of the system that have fought and still are fighting for strengthening of role of women in society and recognition of their contribution to building the peace and stability. But it's very important to emphasize that there are no women in peace in all kind of very important processes. It was no women in Dayton Peace Agreement. It was no women in reconstruction of constitution. It's no women on high political discussion. So that's the fault for sure, because of our political parties, firstly, and secondly, it's also fault of international community. No demand for it, firstly. The secondly, I don't see also the female faces among the international community as well. For sure, you know that we have the high representative. We have several high representative until now, but no one was the woman. Even not the deputy high representative was not woman. So we do not have the good examples among the head of mission of international community. So it's invitation for all women to be fully involved as well on national level, but on international level as such. And with my friend from Libya and Syria, I make joke, we first have to get the UN, the position in UN, and to turn to UN, then to go to our countries and ask for changes in our countries. And always you have the females very active during the war and that kind of the process, because the females are the one who just make the bridges and fulfill all gaps in society when all structure is down. But later on, the women are just forced to go back and leave the space for males. I would like also to share with you that we have a very good and first in the region action plan on implementation 1325 UN resolution, Women, Peace and Security. And that's for us very good tools among other legal framework, which is very good in Bosnia and Herzegovina, but we still have to improve a lot of situation on ground. But 1325 is something, if you properly use it, and we are in the second turn of implementation, and thanks to Institute for Inclusive Security, we got the new second one action plan, and I hope that we can share our experience with friend of ours. Of course. And not just to have, like we discuss in pause, it's not just the dead letter on paper. It's tool that you can make alive and really use it, especially from perspective of human security. Because in our second action plan, we turned from national security to human security. And I think all country that have the problem after the conflict, some even they didn't have the conflict but have unsecure environment and society, can use the good examples of National Action Plan on 1325. Thank you. I will be able to answer all your questions, and my time is over. Thank you for...
Thank you, Samra. Thank you. Our next speaker is Saba Ahalik, a board member of the Syrian Women's League and the Syrian League for Citizenship. Saba joined 50 women from Syrian civil society in Geneva in January at a gathering convened by UN Women before the second round of peace talks. And she was selected as one of four women to represent that group before the media and in meetings with Lakhdar Brahimi to present the Women's Declaration of Priorities. And note that Saba will be giving her remarks in Arabic.
بعد ثلاثة أيام ستمر الثورة السورية في الذكرى الثالثة لها. ولكن إذا أردنا أن نرى سوريا اليوم، سوريا تتغطى باللون الدم، باللون الأحمر، وتتغطى أيضا باللون الأسود، وهو لون الاستبداد السياسي من النظام والسلفيين الذين دخلوا إلى بلادنا من القاعدة. نحن هنا من أجل أن نوقف الدم الأحمر ونوقف اللون الأسود في معهد السلام. كما قال زميلتي، نحن شاركنا في مبادرة النساء ودعيناها سوريات من أجل السلم والديمقراطية. نساء سورية تطلعنا، أنا آسفة للمترجم لأنني سأخرج عن النص، تطلعنا نحن نساء سورية من أجل إيقاف دم كل السوريين وليس فقط دم المعارضة، رغم أننا معارضة لكن دم السوريين هم دم أولادنا جميعا. بادرنا كنساء سوريات وخلال 3 أيام فقط 47 امرأة اجتمعنا في جنيف من مختلف مناطق السورية، اختلاف أيضا الإيديولوجي، اختلاف الديني، اجتمعنا وقررنا جميعا أننا يمكن لنا أن نعمل معا من أجل إيقاف دم السوري ومن أجل الضغط لمجرى عملية السلام. قابلنا الإبراهيمي وطلبنا، وكنا في أيلول 2013 كانت سنة معنا، طلبنا من الإبراهيمي أن تشارك النساء في عملية المفاوضات. تفاجأ بطلبنا وقال لم تكن سابقة لها. قلنا لنكن نحن أول من سيكون على طاولة المفاوضات كنساء وكمجتمع مدني، وضغطنا بهذا الاتجاه بدعم من عدد من المنظمات الدولية وأيضا من UN Women، وأخرجنا وثيقة، هي نشرت هذه الوثيقة، نقول فيها نحن كنساء سوريات سنكون وفدا مستقلا عن جهتي التفاوض، لأننا مجتمع مدني، لأننا نساء، لنا صوت ونستطيع التأثير على الجميع عندما نقول أننا نريد السلام لبلادنا. لم ننجح وبدأت المفاوضات ووضعنا خطة ب، وهي إن لم نكن على طاولة المفاوضات كطرف مستقل يمكن لنا أن نكون ضمن وفد المعارضة ولكن مستقلين أيضا. سنقدم أنفسنا ليس كجهة معارضة سياسية وإنما أيضا كصوت نسائي. أيضا لم ننجح، وضعنا خطة بديلة أن نكون صفة مراقب، على أن نكون ضمن غرفة المفاوضات لكي نستطيع التأثير. إلى الآن لم ننجح في ذلك. كان رد الإبراهيمي أن عملية المفاوضات السورية هي معقدة لأن النظام وطرف المعارضة لم يقبلا على الجلوس ومواجهة بعضهم البعض، ما زال الوسيط هو الذي يحاور الطرفين. هل فقدنا الأمل؟ في أن لا نشارك لن نفقد الأمل. هل نحن نعبر عن نساء سوريا؟ أقول اليوم نعم. لماذا؟ نساء سوريا أغلبية اللاجئات والنازحين هم 85% نساء وأطفال، هم فقراء سوريا، هم نتيجة النظام الاستبدادي الذي أفقر الشعب، هم نسبة أمية كبيرة جدا لدى النساء، هم لا يستطيعن أن يأتين إلى نيويورك ولا جنيف ولا حتى عمان أقرب الدول لكي يصل صوتهم إليكم، لكن نحن نستطيع إيصال هذا الصوت، صوت نساء سورية التي يعانون جميعا وخاصة اللاجئات. أنا أعمل في لبنان مع اللاجئات السوريات يوميا، أنا أعمل معهم. أنهم خرجوا من مذابح جماعية، خرجوا بدون بيوت مع أطفالهم.
Left their houses without their husbands, with their children. Most of them have no skills to work. When we ask them, we are going to Geneva, or we are going to New York to talk and to say that we want to stop the killing in Syria, they say, yes, go, because we are tired 3 years and we are paying the price of this war, the price of the oppression and the dictatorship of a regime that gave us nothing. I have been involved in women's issues for 25 years. The Syrian regime didn't change any discrimination or discrimination article against women, not in the law of nationality. The Syrian woman cannot give her nationality to her children if she marries a foreigner, nor in the law of all other rules and laws are discriminating against women. This regime, which brags about secularity, didn't improve any article that targets women and that discriminates against women. The situation of women have become even more difficult when those women go back to their houses or when they return to their country. They have no property title deeds because only men possess and have the right to possess houses. We have learned this from the Bosnians. When we went to the Bosnia and Herzegovina, women were in need to prove that they possess a house that was destroyed. Majority of houses are owned by men. Most of the lands are owned by men. How can we compensate those women? We have learned from the Bosnians that the title deed, that the testimony of a woman, they managed to try 1,000 murderers taking the testimony of women. We encourage those who were detained, those who were raped, those who suffered sexual harassment, that they can go and give evidence before the court. Without the evidence given by women, there will be no justice. We call on those who left Daria. Daria is a region in north of Damascus which witnessed the collective murders. A refugee woman was telling me that the smell of blood remains with me. I have seen cars and trucks carrying the bodies of our children. How can she forgive? If I don't tell her, her testimony will help in treating the murderer to justice. We encourage them to be courageous and to talk about what they suffered and what they faced. It's difficult to find those who will agree and admit rape. Women, when I ask them, was there rape? They say yes. And they say, who? They said, we have just heard. We know that it is difficult to admit to being a victim of rape because of our cultural specificity. Some were killed by their families in order to avoid the stigma that they lost their honor. Some women were forced to marry in order to protect themselves with a man whom they don't know, and they will spend their long life with him. We want peace, and we remain committed to peace. We will press in the direction of peace, and I believe that all institutes and all organizations, governmental, international, non-governmental, must support the Syrian women, because it is our right to live. It is the right of our refugee women to return in dignity to their country. It is our right to enjoy democracy. I never lose hope that me, personally, I used to dream that my daughter will live in a democracy. I still stick, even though few years are remaining, to live in democracy, to see the freedom of my country. The Syrian women, when I talk to them, what do you want when we return to our country? Do you want houses, health, education? Now they say, we only want peace and security. We want freedom and justice. We can live in a camp and build our country together. But to feel that there is peace, there is freedom, and there is justice. Thank you.
Thank you, Saba. And I'm sure everyone will be eager to hear more in the question session. Our next presenter is Farida Alaki, president of the Libyan Forum for Civil Society. Women were widely recognized in 2011 as playing a large role in initiating the revolution in Libya. This was noted in early mediation efforts, but their place at the table has been undermined over the last 2 years. Farida?
Good evening. And excuse me, I'm jet lagging. Usually I'm in bed by now. I'm very touched by my Syrian sister, and we support you very much. And what she has said about Syria, we went through it for a while in Libya. I would like, before I start giving you a few remarks, very quick remarks, to really, from my heart, to thank the International Peace Institute and definitely to thank our friends Sanam and the International Civil Society Action Network. I usually very tough to thank people. You will hear what I'm going to comment on some of our partner. But really this institute and Sanam, I think, you know, for me are really an icon, a model that many other agencies should follow. So thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to be here. I'm sure, I don't know how much you know about Libya, very quickly, 6 million people, 60% under the age of 25. Very rich country, a country that has been led by a dictator for 42 years, a country that has been forgotten by the West, in a sense, particularly for us as women, because the West interest in Libya was the oil. So all the principle about the human rights and democracy was not really in action when these dictators were ruling us. Accordingly, the prices that we are paying today are the accumulation of what, quote unquote, the big superpowers, the pro-democracy agents that are now pushing us that we need really to do miracles, have been contributing to it. So that's my really first remark. As you have said, my colleague Samra, again, history is repeating itself. I wonder why. Women, the Palestinian women, the Algerian women, at least I'm talking about our region, the Egyptian women, for the last 50, 60 years, they were leading revolution. And that's what happened now in the Arab Springs. But again, what happens? So we need to start rethinking. We need to start questioning new questions. We need to be tough in evaluating what went wrong with us and why. And what should be going on further? I think the younger generation, we should be humble to tell them our mistakes. Now in Libya, of course, the Libyan women, the Libyan revolution started by Libyan women in Benghazi. Wake up, Benghazi. Yeah. Powerful Libyan women were screaming and men followed. And that was the beginning, you know, of our revolution. I'm not going to go into details. I have only a few minutes. I have lots of things to say. But then, okay, now everybody says the Libyan women were cooking, women only cooking, extension of the kitchen. Yes, they were cooking, but many of these courageous Libyan women were smuggling arms, were collecting money, were distributing medical supplies, were working, and the younger generation of Libya played a tremendous role with the technology and the internet. And I have been in the opposition against Gaddafi 42 years. So those of us who have been facing that dictatorship for 42 years, we mobilized 1,200 women and we really moved, you know, more than maybe the men have done. But again, we were humble, low key. We didn't appear in the television. We didn't talk about ourselves as being heroes. We were just doing it for our country. The difference that happened in Libya, that it's not happening in Syria, we were united. And the interesting part that when the revolution sparked in Libya, the elderly, the rural, the urban, the poor, the educated, the not educated, All came together. No class, no education. Grandmothers were pushing their grandchildren to go to the war zone. Many young girls in the villages, they say, we were never able to leave our village, and our parents, they were pushing us, go out, even if we stay late in the streets. It was really, really, because again, you know, the West, when you see, and I'm sure many of you have seen the fantastic Yemeni women who are all covered, but this was not covered. They were very courageous, and they were leading the revolution. Today, after, you know, the revolution ended, after the men jumped on it, and the Libyan revolution has been hijacked, primarily by Islam's fundamentalists, primarily by greedy politicians. Many of them were with me in the opposition, but now they are, you know, sadly in positions of power, corrupt and collecting money. The prime minister was just kicked out yesterday and he fled the country. So sadly enough, we were totally, and I want you, I have been sitting listening to the, with all my due respect, I can't generalize, you know, because I have been with the UN circle for many years, I'm coming to that. All these speeches of all these governments, so please don't believe what these governments, many of them, even in the Arab world, trying to really show Libya is really honoring its treaties. No, they're not. We are now, even the little gains that many women have achieved, they are totally tarnished. Totally. They put, as usual, one or two women just to please the West that we have two ministers. Weak women, scary women, many of them, no voice of women. So this is the women that they want to show to the international community. I come now to the international community. Sadly enough, and that's where I really want to conclude, Libya, you know, among, of course, today the chaos is tremendous. No security, kidnapping, torture. The last human rights reports in Libya is really sad. Displaced refugees, corruption, name it, sadly enough. But we are fixing that, and we will fix that. And we will never leave Libya again to them, okay? So the international community, sadly enough, pulled out of Libya very quickly. How you pull out of a nation, of course, I need to recognize that the international community supported our revolution. And I need to be a realist. Without the NATO, Gaddafi would have still been in power, slicing us into pieces like they left him hanging us in the streets of Libya. I myself have been followed with my husband and shot to be killed here in the United States in Colorado. So the international community with the NATO supported us for whatever reasons, but of course, Gaddafi, they waited to see, will this revolution succeed or not? So they waited until he killed so many of us, and then when they felt that this revolution is really moving forward, they interfered. Libya is oil, Libya on the Mediterranean Sea, Libya is in the north of Africa, and Libya is a good piece of cake that they want to continue to slice and to share. Never mind, so that has taken place. Now, the international community pulled out, and we had a transitional council. And sadly enough, that was the beginning of really the sad catastrophe for Libyan women losing everything. It started with the transitional council, and it kept accumulating. We had two parties. Of course, we had no civil society during Gaddafi. We had no political parties. We are different from Egypt and Syria. We had nothing. We had no institution. We have nothing. Therefore, that's what we're trying to tell the international community. Don't think we have the magic stick that after 3 years, you want us to have human rights, you want us to have democracy, you want us to change the country. It will not happen. But sadly enough, I have to confess, and those of you who are with government or are with international agencies, the time has come that we need to be honest. We need to open the files. The funding, the work, the strategies that has been taking place in our country, so much money has been lost. So much money has been in vain. Little technical workshop, No strategic policies have been taking place. So many international experts who are paid so much money sitting on the beaches and pretending they are coming to defend women or to work on behalf of women. Cannot continue. We have been talking about this for the last maybe 20 years. I'm getting old, I'm 66. I have been with this UN building here since 1975. My patience is really running out. I think it's enough. We have to say enough is enough. The game is over. We made our revolution. Either you help us the way we think you should be interfering or help us, or leave us alone. Stay away from us. We will fix ourselves. Because I think it is unfair in the name of women, in the name of insecurity, in the name of the poor, in the name of democracy, in the name of what are these thousands of papers and documents and I don't know negotiations and blah, 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 blah. It's not doing any change for anybody, believe me. And we, of course, I am part of a big network. Sisterhood is global. We as women are sisters. We are united. But now she's telling me 1 minute, okay.
I hate to do it.
So I recall in the early 70s, I was much younger when we started really with the women's network. We were fighting the West and the North and the South. But now I think, yes, indeed, sisterhood is global. When you say a man, all women say, yes, we know what you mean. Regardless of, forget about culture, forget about religion, forget about where we come from. Women globally are discriminated against in different degrees. And I think, I swear, I think strongly, and I hope that this can come true. It is time really to revisit the language that we're using. It is time now in Libya, what we're doing. The minute you talk women, they are deaf, these politicians and these men. We're not talking women. We're talking corruption. We're talking transitional justice. We're talking rule of law. We're talking governance. That is our entry point. And everybody listens to us. Not only that, we as women played a very, and we were still humble about it. We didn't brag about it. And I'm telling the younger generation, never be humble. Take credit for what you are doing. We have been too humble. And all these men stealing many of our brains and our action and our everything. So we played a major role in bringing many different parties together to have an initiative for a peaceful transition of power. It is not happening. We had only 2 weeks ago, many of you have followed that, a meeting in Rome, who are many governments, including the United States, all European governments, went to Rome to discuss security in Libya. And we asked, and this is the fourth meeting, not a single Libyan woman has been, no civil society. So I think we cannot no longer keep nagging or keep requesting or keep please giving us. Something needs to be done differently. Now we are building a coalition, Libya, with youth. Women and youth and minority. It's a new power that's coming together, and we are telling the international order, this is how we need to monitor, we need to measure the impact. No measurement of what's taking place, no evaluation of who's doing what. They're asking us to coordinate, they're not coordinating among themselves. The European Union competing with the UN, UN women, we know nothing about them except in the news sometimes, and so, we, of course, I do recognize the few good examples that we have. But please, those of you from governments, talk to your government official, because when we come and talk to some ambassadors or to some governments, they say, yeah, but when it comes to women, it's an internal matter. When it comes to oil and business and corruption and blah, 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 it's not an internal matter. So I think we decided from now on, as Libyan women, our top priority is security. We, many women, I have to recognize, I have three of my friends with me here, Maysoon, who's working on corruption and following our wasted money all over the globe. Everybody's stealing it. Madiha, who's on violence against women, and Khadija, who is very, very active, and she's a writer and a poet and artist and very, very active with women. So what we are deciding now, we are only and only focusing on one thing, politics, 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 and now I'm pushing women to business, 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 because money and politics is what's making change. Otherwise, we will continue for the next 100 years listening to what we're listening in that tall building. Thank you very much.
Thank you for certainly raising the level of passion here, and we've had such great stories of persistence and passion already, I think. Our next speaker is Mirsad Miki Jakovic, the Vice Chair of the Institute for Inclusive Security. Miki is another native of Bosnia-Herzegovina who has worked extensively on training women leaders in his own country, but also in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Colombia, and Liberia.
Well, there were tough acts to follow in my history. This is impossible. So let me fake it. Bear with me. Give me 3 minutes. So I just cut me off because I know you're here to hear them. Let me again first thank IPI and my teacher and mentor, Sana Mandalini, who has taught me everything I try to know about this and many other topics. I want to cover this simply because let me start with debunking one myth that I keep hearing around the world when we come to the question of inclusion. And so either youth, women, etc., we cannot bring them to the people because where are the women? We don't know the women. They aren't out there. And here they are, not only at this stage, but all over the world. And it, again, it is time for all of us to, again, wake up that building across the streets and all the other governments, but also women and men around the world to understand inclusion is the only sustainable way. I don't know theories, I don't teach, I kind of do this work, but what I know for sure is that what happened in my native Bosnia, and Samra told you, and what's unfortunately happening in Syria, is that the warfare has changed. The war has come to our homes. It's on our streets, in our schools, it's on our doorsteps. But the nature of how we make peace has not changed. We still think about nation states, about these powerful men who get to sit on this table, and essentially that myth has to change. We have to catch up with the reality of these stories and change how we solve the conflicts and deal with peacemaking. There are three things I want to highlight. The question of why does it matter? The simple answer is not only do women build these bridges that we keep hearing and really are socially invested. For those of you who don't know, another personal hero of mine in the room, Vishaka Dharamdasa, who does this work simply because she had a missing son. And women as mothers, as leaders, simply pick up these pieces, and we recognize that in the midst of the war, but we fail to do that institutionally when the bullets stop. And so we really need to debunk the second myth, which is there's no enough research. If I hear that one more time, I will buy yet another book that Sanam has written and many pieces of research that we've seen, because it's simply out there for those of us who want to see, including all these senior mediators, that when you meet with 50 Syrian women, how can you ask what are their contributions? Mm-hmm. The mere fact, and then the third myth that, as you can see, your passion translated to me, so I'm also going to go crazy. I will have a glass of wine afterwards. So the third myth is that, oh, if only the women were united, we would really like 3 million Libyan women to get together and have one voice. But let's have these 70 warlords in the Afghan parliament each have his own army and tribe. But please, every single Afghan woman that you have met, unify.
Yes.
The next question, so that's a bit on why. I was asked by IPI to pretend I'm smart and I can provide the theory behind these smart women. So the second piece is who decide? What does inclusion mean? And that's the second piece. When we decide who, we start, well, it always should be, you know, warring political parties, typically translating into guys with the guns. And again, it does not translate to reality of who that conflict was impacting. And again, many of you in this room have heard the story that our beloved friend Mabina Jaffer, who was helping negotiate Darfur talks, there's that episode where all these negotiators, the men, were the rebel leaders who lived in Europe for years.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds familiar?
Mm-hmm.
And they were at the negotiating table, being flown, by the way, in business class to many a Doha wonderful retreat to negotiate the table. After 7 years of many of us pushing and trying, several women got to these negotiations, and they finally realized for the last 5 years, these guys have been stuck about the map. Bosnia, Dayton. MAP is where they're stuck the most, because what do they want? Territory. And so after many a negotiation, they were stuck. They can't figure out this particular piece of land. The next thing they know, a couple of women from civil society who finally got that peak of that infamous status observer. God. So we got observer women to come and observe. And obviously, any of you who had met women from Darfur, they ain't going to observe. They just went straight in there and said, what the hell's problem? What are you guys stuck about? And when they realized that they were stuck about a piece of map, they were fighting about the river that actually dried out 2 years ago. And so that's that perspective, what women do bring, and civil society more broadly, of the reality of that finger on the pulse of the communities is what is solely needed for these processes. The third aspect is how. How can inclusion work? I think, you know, we hear these examples of these national level processes, and clearly there's lots to fix, and I will leave Sanam to kind of wrap it all apart in terms of all the solutions that she will figure out. But I do want to say there are exciting news, and I'll bring some from the work I'm currently doing in the Philippines and Afghanistan, which is there are such things as provincial peace councils or the national dialogue or inclusive processes, which is essentially community-led or provincial-led, where you do have these joint shuras, where the young people, the women, the mullahs, the elders come together and try to discuss this concept, which is essentially what this boiled to, which is what is preventing me to feel safe? How do I go out of my home? How do I send my children to school? How do I get access to jobs or justice or whatever? So that means essentially really taking that upside down concept of this serious national security that only guys in uniforms can discuss to women saying we can help refigure what security means and translate that obviously to the needs of the community. And finally, what it is. Again, really, every time we raise this, we hear so many times, let us fix security, let us get the streets, let us really take the arms from the men and the boys typically, or let us really build the constitution, and then we'll get to women's issues. Yeah. And again, I want to really make clear, all of these issues are women's issues. Security on the street is a women's issue. Access to justice is a women's issue. All what peace translate to in today's conflict is a women's issue. So as somebody famous said, women's rights are human rights. Security issues are women's issues. And I will stop now.
Thank you. You're the best. Very good.
Thank you. And finally, we turn to our co-host this evening, Sanam Anderlini, the co-founder of ICAN, who I'm sure many of you know. She's been working on these issues for nearly two decades. In 2000, she was one of the civil society drafters of UN Resolution 1325. And in 2011, Sanam was the first senior expert on gender and inclusion on the UN mediation standby team of experts. Sanam?
Thank you. I'm going to pay Mickey for lunch for promoting my book. I'm going to give him my glass of wine. Now, first of all, thank you very much for co-hosting with us and for this amazing discussion and this level of honesty. I also wanted to just give a note of thanks to Senator Jaffer, Mobina Jaffer, who was actually meant to be with us and couldn't because of a family emergency. She would have also added a lot of spice to the conversations. So I think, I mean, you know, in terms of wrapping it up, as for me, one of the things that we need to understand, or when I think about the role of the UN, first of all, I'm always struck by the fact that we as civil society are so committed to the ideals of the UN. And the ideals of the UN, never again war, you know, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, etc. These are serious issues because we live with them. I'm Iranian. I understand what it means to live with, you know, conflict and transition and all the challenges that come with having turmoil in your country. We're not doing this because we think it's fun. We're doing it because we get it and we live with it. And yet the attitude that we consistently have is, you're advocates. You don't know stuff. Or you're feminists. God forbid, you are feminists. You're gonna, you know, what do you do? It's cultural. One of the comments that I've had over the years as I've worked on both sides, if you want, within and outside. You know, everywhere you go, they will tell you women are absent because of culture, as we heard, right? Except it's universal, right? So if it was culture, what would happen in Colombia should be different to what's happening in Libya, It's not. It's the same story. It's because it's about power, and it's about the way that peace and security has always been in the domain of the military and political elite. And even though the problem has changed, as we've heard, the solution has stayed the same, the way we try and deal with it. And it's not a wonder that 50% of the time there's a failure. You know, how is it working for us, for Israel and Palestine? Same guys, over and over. You know, Geneva 2, Somalia 55. I mean, it just goes on and on. And yet, the willingness to try something different is not there. And I'm struggling to understand why that doesn't happen. Another thing that is very interesting for me is, again, this notion of challenging the legitimacy of civil society coming forward. The statement that I've heard with my own ears and others have heard, I think many of us have heard here, is who are these women anyway? Just think about that. That is what is often said by policymakers mm-hmm. about people like Saba and Samra and all our colleagues. Who are these women anyway? And I just want to, just for a moment, think about it. These are people who are standing up in the middle of the most horrendous, dangerous situations. They're not standing up with weapons. They're standing up with our voices and with our values. And we have international colleagues who turn around and say, who are they anyway? That's outrageous. Mm-hmm. It's just plain outrageous, right? And it's institutional, it's bureaucratic, it's situational, if you want, but it doesn't mean that we shouldn't change the attitude. The question for me, I mean, if I wanted to be generous about how the system has evolved, I would say 20 years ago when I started this work, I was working in England, we were working with Sierra Leoneans, the war in Sierra Leone was going on, and getting the RUF, the armed rebel forces, into the, you know, to get a peace process going with a non-state armed group was very difficult because they were considered as illegitimate, they were terrorists, and one can say whatever one wants about non-state armed actors, but the fact of the matter is that back in the 1990s, we began to see that this is the nature of war. We're dealing with non-state, we're dealing with civil war. Civil war means that somebody's fighting the state. And chances are there's a reason why they're fighting the state, right? We uphold, the UN system upholds the state, we bow to the state. But frankly, if people inside the country are fighting the state, there must be a reason for it. Now, back in the 90s, we didn't recognize non-state armed actors. We've evolved because we realize that's the reality. These are the guys we have to talk to. And we've gone to the other extreme. Mm-hmm. Business class tickets, 3 years for the Darfuris, I think it was 3 years in hotels in Doha. They brought their wives, they had babies there. It was extraordinary. I mean, it's that level of support, right? We give them training, we give them DSA, daily supplemental allowances, et cetera, et cetera. Why? Because we need to talk to the spoilers. We need to talk to the guys, you know, to stop the fighting, because the issue is to stop the fighting. What's not recognized is that as we have non-state armed actors, we also have the emergence of non-state unarmed actors who are much more committed to the idea of peace and live peace through violence and live and want a sustainable solution to their problems, as we're seeing here. And yet those voices are the ones that are being checked. Who are they? What are they? You know, and the logic, the logic that we end up with is that if the women of Syria were armed, if the women of Libya yep. were armed, if the women of Afghanistan formed, as we said the other day in Washington, you know, Talibanata, yep. maybe we would bring yep. them to the table, because now they're dangerous, now they're spoilers, now they're bad news. But the good news, we sideline them. Mm-hmm. Consistently, if there's anybody who's committed, we say, who are they, and so forth. Or we say things like, there's a war going on. I had one person say, there's a war going on, you know. And I said, yes, and half the population is women, and they're out there. I mean, yes, there's a war going on. The women are out there. As, you know, they're not, even if they're cooking, even only they're cooking, they're still there, right? So there is this constant kind of notion that, you know, maybe it's just cool to think that you're out there and you're going out and you're talking to the big bad guys. I don't know what it is. I don't really get it. But to me, it's been this challenge that, why do we systematically undermine and delegitimize the voices who are courageous enough to stand up, not using violence, and sideline them when we really need them, because they are we should be on their side, and they are certainly on our side if we think a political solution needs to happen. So this is the challenge. Now, what have we, in terms of solutions, what have we looked at? We know that there are different models of doing this. It's not true that it's never happened that women aren't at the table. as the Syrians were. It's just not, it's just plain not true. It's happened in Liberia, it happened in Somalia, it happened in Northern Ireland. It's happened in many, many places. So one of the things that's happening is what I call evaporation of effort. Okay, things get done, things move forward. Instead of building on it, somehow it evaporates and it disappears. Okay, imagine if in the tech industry, Apple had come up with its computer 30 years ago and left it there. No, they build and now we have the iPhone, right? In our world, you build it and then it gets erased and then somebody else rebuilds the same cranky old thing and then it's even worse and then it's even, what kind of professionalism is this? Yeah. I mean, think about it, right? We have 50% failure rates in peace processes. Would you go to a heart surgeon with a 50% success? Seriously. Would you go to a financial advisor with your pension fund who had a 50% chance of keeping your money safe for you? No. These are people's lives we're talking about. Yeah. Right? And yet, we just carry on and we diminish those who are trying to do something differently. So it really needs, it's a change of attitude that needs to happen. Now, the other question we get is, civil society, who are they? How many of them? Which ones? Who's legitimate? You know, what do we know? They're political. Of course they're going to be political and non-political, and of course they are. But if we look at some of these, who are the other folks that get to be there?
Exactly.
Right? To me, the question isn't, are they legitimate and who are? It's, what are they doing? Let's look at the criteria. Let's think about criteria of who you would want in a process to think about peace and the future of a country. You want your folks who know the humanitarian conditions. You want the folks who are committed to the values of human rights and democracy and peace and reconciliation, right? You want the folks who know what's happening on the ground in terms of security and ceasefires and who are willing to roll up their sleeves. Let's look at criteria. At the moment, we have no criteria and we just throw everything out. Right? And we're not willing even to apply criteria. And when we do it on the basis of ethnicity or religion. Mm-hmm. So we say, we'll have, you know, a couple of Sunnis and a couple of Shias. And we take a country that has not ever thought about itself in that way. Like that. And we create divisions. And then we even create new ethnic groups and minorities, because that's that in some of the places in Asia we've seen this. So instead of listening to the locals who are committed and who are going to live with the problems and the future and do not have an exit strategy, instead of listening and working with them and planning together with them, we determine for them and then we parse them out and say who's eligible and not. And then finally we have this, it's not our job, it's up to the delegations. Who are the delegations, right? But even if we did that, even if we said to the delegations, bring 50% women, bring 50% civil society, at least maybe we'd have some voices there. We don't do that. These are folks that we pay for. It's, if you want, it's our party. I mean, we pay for all the things, and then we allow them to carry on. And other things that we hear, women are fine. I heard that actually in the case of Libya. Oh, the women are fine.
Yeah.
The women are doing a great job. They're fine. They don't need, like, are you kidding me? Do you know what's going to happen? Do we know what kind of process, what happens when you get extreme Islamists coming into a space? It's just not okay to be like this. And it's, you know, and these are attitudes that we're seeing across international institutions writ large. I'm not going to say it's one place or another. It's literally every international institution, government. At some point, you hear one of these types of things, culture and this and that. And it's more to do with the ignorance and the inertia and the bureaucracy here than it is to do what's happening on the ground. And the humility we need here is I think, the starting point. We have to be humble. We have to recognize that when a war comes into somebody's home, maybe you want to talk to the women in the community to figure out what's the best way to talk to the guys. What's the best act? Do you talk to them about their children and their daughters and so forth? Instead of sitting and saying, oh no, in Pakistan, you know, can't talk, women can't talk to the Taliban. In Afghanistan and Pakistan, women are constantly negotiating with the Taliban. Constantly. Okay. So we don't, out of our own ignorance, we're making policies which then impact people's lives. And we move on from one place to another, repeating and undermining. It's got to stop, because it's really getting us to a very, very dangerous place. It's making the international systems more irrelevant. It's making the world a much more dangerous place. And I'll end on one final note. If women were not important, you wouldn't have the first speech by the Libyan Transitional Authority on the status of women. Okay? If women were not important, you wouldn't have so many attacks on women in Egypt and Syria and elsewhere and elsewhere. The folks that are coming in recognize the power of women in their societies. And that's why they're after it. Yep. And meanwhile, we in the West sit here and say, women's rights, but not here and there and everywhere because it's cultural and really women aren't that important. So it's they get it. They get it and they're harnessing it. And this side of the argument, I think, is losing it. Thank you.
Now we're going to turn straight to your questions because I'm sure we'll have many more than we end up having time for. So we'll take three questions at a time and then return to the panel. Direct your question to a specific person or leave it open. One reminder that we're webcasting tonight's event, so please identify yourself with your name and affiliation. And again, please keep your question as brief as possible.
Hi there, Maria O'Reilly, the International Peace Institute. Thank you so much to ICAN for co-hosting this excellent event with us and to all of you for your really honest remarks. It's so refreshing. I'm very curious, you know, I think often what we hear from people who are structuring peace processes, who are in mediation support teams is, you know, what are the models that we can draw on? This hasn't really happened before. And what are the tools that we can use to connect women to the peace process, to integrate them into it? I'm curious if any of you have thoughts on that for mediators who are shaping processes themselves and for other people who are supporting that work, what advice do you have to give them for including women in the peace process?
I want to thank all of you. This was amazing. Thank you, thank you, thank you. My name is Sally Kater, and I'm with the U.S. Federation for Middle East Peace. And I have been working to empower women in the Middle East for all my life, I guess, but the past 14 years. So, I have so many things to say and questions and so on and so forth, but I will be very short. I was amazed when you said about Akhdar Brahimi that he thought it was kind of unusual to have women participate in the negotiation. I know him personally, and this is something that we really have to push forward because it was the first time that was asked that way. As for Libya, my goodness, you really are amazing. And I think you should stay in that energy because this is what we need. As you know, we have the women conference now. And everybody is trying to always say that whatever is politically correct to say. But this is not about politically correctness. This is about what you are suffering. And the only people who will talk about it and make something happen is the people who are suffering. I just came back from the Zaatari refugee camp in Jordan, where the Syrian refugees are. And I cried, and it affected me so much because of the women suffering and the girls, what's going on. And I have yet to find one official who will tell me the truth. None of them did. They kept saying, no, this is, we do not interfere in traditions or religious practices. What religious and what tradition that will make you sell a girl for 10 years old for whatever reasons, the so-called money or security or not suffering or being raped and so on. So they have so much to understand. So let me know what it is we can do and how do you want to tackle this? Please let me know. Thank you.
We'll go to Kai, and then I know there's many more hands, so I've been keeping track for the next round.
Hello, Kai Stavel, independent researcher. Ukhti, yatik lelf afi. It's amazing to hear such power and such really important sort of just the oomph that we need to push. But the problem that I'm facing and the problem we're facing every day is we're preaching to the choir. All of us in here are in unison. So how do we sing the same song to the people that need to listen? And as my friend here pointed out, Lakhdar Ibrahimi saying it's complicated makes me want to puke. Because it's, how can it be too complicated? How can you not include women, and how can you say it's complicated? And I would like to hear from the panelists, how can we break this? How can we all together find a way to push? Because it's pointless. We live once, we have one opportunity to do something different. And every time we see it over and over again, women left out of every single negotiation. We're seeing it now in Libya, we're seeing it in Egypt, we're seeing it in Tunisia, we're seeing it everywhere else. Women are added as an addendum at the end. It's like taking a course at university, and at the very end you have women and whatever course you did. How can we together help you push with the same vigor as we've heard today? And I also want to say thank you for a brilliant panel and really engaging talk. Thank you.
Thank you. So if anyone wants to address, those were some broader questions, so we'll see.
Do you want to start with the models? Sure. As I said, the models, number one, we have evaporation of effort and knowledge of what has been done. But if you look at Guatemala, there was a civil society forum where you had women, indigenous groups, human rights groups, the church, various sectors of civil society came together. They then, within each sector, they voted for their own representatives who then went on to wherever the peace talks happened, right? So they actually had a voice, there was an ongoing connection, the papers, that issues that were addressed and so forth. So we have that. Same with, in Northern Ireland, they had it both. They had a civil society forum and the mediator went into the space, saw that you have big political parties on either side, but also some other voices. So he said, let's have elections and have 10, they could have elections, let's have 10 political parties come to the table. If you win, and the women, what the women, Catholics and Protestants had been working together for many years at a grassroots level, they went to political parties, they realized that the parties were not interested in their vision. So they formed their own party, and within 6 weeks, they came ninth in the process, and they had a seat at the table. But it was the mediator took the prerogative of redesigning and reconfiguring what he thought would be a way of bringing in and ensuring the multiple voices that he could. And by the way, the women were doing internal mediation. They were the ones who were talking to the IRA when the IRA wasn't at the table, because they had Catholics and Protestants from both sides and had access in different ways. In Somalia, where I did some work with the UN this year, but back in 1999, The Department of Political Affairs invited women's groups to be observers at the Djibouti peace talks, and the peace process was five clans. It's clan-based, five clans. The women went, they said, where are the women? And the clan said, the clans are male-dominated, so it's men. So the women got together, and they formed the sixth clan, the women's clan, and they got themselves in. You know, so you give an opera, you give an inch, and they will take the mile, right? Fast forward, that was 1999. In 2011, that entire story had disappeared. People in the international system did not know that women had a space. They didn't know that there had been meetings where women had made a third of the delegations of the Somalis. So where is the learning of the past, right? We still got civil society. We still got women's voices into the Garaway process and very good language. But it's amazing how it had to be reinvented. And frankly, with Syria, I call it, it was the Geneva meetings in January, Geneva 2, number 2. I call it women were in Geneva 2, T-O-O, because they were there. They were there. But they weren't observers. They were having side meetings. We have to be pushing ourselves to say, what did we achieve this time? Yes, it was amazing what was done so soon, because for Libya, we got nothing, right? So the first, but can we do a little bit better? Can we be pushing ourselves for a better standard to build on the good lessons and build the foundations, not go backwards? There are many models. We can talk about it. And Inclusive Security has done a great paper with 9 different models of this.
And I think now we have Farida and then Samra as well.
Yeah.
The frustration is when we are in our countries, every day counts. And every day, many women are now fleeing the country for various reasons. And many women are just giving up because it's too much the pressure. I really think you need superhumans to continue to fight. We are in a roller coaster. You know, up to yesterday, today, I was talking with Madiha. I told her, I'm 66 years old. I always knew since I was a little girl what I want. Now I'm confused. I'm lost. I'm torn. I have some health problem. I had a tumor. It was benign. I'm afraid it will come back to me because I need to finish my agenda in Libya. So, you know, we are on daily basis torn, killing, kidnapping, loss of hope, irrationalism, confusion. And now all the friends of Libya who met in Rome, who gave speeches, they don't have the solution. They are messed up. And I was in Greece, I was in Italy. Europe is messed up. They have a big rate of unemployment. They have a big mess with political system. The dollar and the economics is falling. So, I mean, at times the West want to fix us and they're not fixing themselves either. So this is also a dilemma. What we need, we have been trying as Arab women, particularly after the Arab Revolution. I myself went to many UN agencies. I strongly believe we need to build a strong network of powerful Arab women, particularly the human rights activists, the pro-democracy, because we need to really support each other. We need to keep pushing and to keep fighting and not to give up. We need to learn from each other. We need to innovate new thinking, because at times we have brilliant women, brilliant, brilliant, but our energy is dispersed. You need to do everything. You need to go to a demonstration. You need to negotiate. You need to solve a problem. You need to be careful that a bullet while you are driving in the city and they are fighting. We have militia. We need to negotiate with the youth, and that's what we are doing in Libya. And now this is what we are really focusing on. We need to focus. We need to focus. Security, security, security. And we need to be in, for example, now we are engaging we want to start engaging grandparents. The grandparent, you know, the grandmother is very, 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 very respectable in our culture in Libya. So if the grandmother will come to her grandson and she will tell him, you are no longer my grandson if you don't put your arm, I think that will be a miracle in really these young people, you know, giving up arms. So we need to network. We also need, you know, the technical, the 1325 workshop, the too theoretical. Yeah. Many of these women, they don't understand these big words, big language, big, this expert, they need to be simple in really giving, you know, simple example. We need to know how they did it in other culture, in what way, what are the innovative approaches. So this is, we really need, and we need to focus, and we need sustainability, and we need to tell the UN system, for heaven's sake, stop these 3 days workshops, stop these 5 days meeting workshops, and pictures. And then they have a big meeting, and then they give certificate, and then the ambassadors come, and then the media come, and as if, and then nothing happens, nothing, no change. So this is what we need.
Related to how we can involve as more women as possible, I would suggest, from my experience, of course, to involve civil society, but from grassroots as is possible. It's very important. And don't support in this country, that's our experience, NGOs financially, and don't make them, I mean, support them financially, but on an open way. Don't make civil society in this country donor-driven. That's big dangerous, because then you get the industry of civil society, and just really support the ordinary grassroots NGOs who are able to assess real needs of women on the ground. That's very important, because other way you just build like opposition of NGOs, and you don't get the right partners, and you don't hear, you are not able to hear the right voices. Thank you.
Saba, if you don't mind, will we go to the audience for one more round and then come to you first? Okay. Because I'm worried we'll run out of time. So first I saw the woman in red here in the front.
The woman in red.
Yes.
Yeah, woman in red. Thank you.
And please identify yourself, don't forget.
Oh yeah, yes. My name is Claudine, Claudine from Rwanda. I survived the genocide over there. My parents were killed, my grandparents were killed, my uncle, my auntie, my sister, she were raped, and then they cut her with machetes. So she died. So I am here tonight for an invitation of my dear sister. Thank you for inviting me. So the question I was going to ask, he asked it, how we can help you. So now I'm going to make a comment. I have an organization called Why Do I Exist, whydoiexist.org. We work to help the orphans in Rwanda to improve their lives. As you know, in genocide, we have over a million of orphans. We have many girls who are taking care of the young siblings because no one is there to help them. So they drop out from the school because they had to sacrifice the young siblings' future. So my comment I would love to make is to you, my sister. I love the fact your organization said, I can. Yeah, we can. When we hear a sister from Libya, we understand that we can. So my comment is, those people who tell you that the women are okay, tell them, the women, they are not okay because Claudine's mother, my mom, were killed in a refugee camp, believing that we escaped the genocide, but still in a refugee camp, she were killed. So anytime they tell you the women are okay, tell them no, because Claudine's mother were killed in a refugee camp. When the airplane of our president was shut down, the first person were killed in the same night. She was a woman, the prime minister. She was not killed because she was Tutsi, because the genocide was the Hutu were killed the Tutsi. They killed my relatives and my family because we were Tutsi. She was a Hutu. Only the reason why she was killed is because she was going to take over. Because in the constitution of our country, when a president dies, the prime minister take over. So she was killed because she was a woman, so they didn't want a woman to take over. That's my comment. God bless you.
Thank you. I saw Sana next over there.
Thank you. My name is Sana Tielemans. I work with Conciliation Resources, a London-based peacebuilding organization. I want to thank all of you for being so inspiring, not just tonight, but in the work that you do on a daily basis. You inspire me as a younger generation, and I want to thank you for that. I also wanted to reflect a bit on the topic of tonight. We're talking about changing peacemaking. I can but echo what you've been asking and bringing up here today about that we need to think differently about peacemaking. And I have a question or a call for reflection, if you like, from the panel on this. Because I would say that we need to go even beyond asking who gets the seat at the table, what is peacemaking like. We need to talk about how we go about peace processes more generally. Peace processes are very exclusionary nature. Like you said, we talk to the potential spoilers. This is important. But we kind of really focus all our attention on the official efforts. We focus on the top level. We call it track one even. And there is much happening at grassroots level, particularly by women's organizations. And this is called track two, track three. I wonder how you feel about this. This is not time for us to say track one is not the right word, maybe. Maybe we need to talk about multiple paths to peace. Maybe it's time to think differently about how we go about peace processes. So I'd be really keen to hear your reflections on that. Thank you.
Yes. And then next I had nodded at this woman.
Hello, my name is Lise Østby. I work for the Norwegian Directorate. It's called the Directorate for Children, Youth and Family Affairs, but it also includes gender equality. And I have a question to you.
What would you want from governments who already recognize the challenges and finance a lot of development and organizations and see the challenges that you see, like the government of Norway, who still cannot show good examples of where they have facilitated peace processes. They have also failed to include women, even if they recognize the challenge. So do you have any specific questions for governments like Norway's that recognize the challenge and want to change the status of women in this processes? What can they do specifically? What can they do in practice when they facilitate these processes? Thank you.
So I think, I'm so sorry, but we'll take one more question and then go back to the panel. What will be the last round, I think. So I saw Mavic raising her hand.
Thank you, and I would like to thank IPI once again. And I feel, I echo your point about, you know, we need to sing this same song to another audience. I feel like I have a lot of IPI classmates already, you know, with all of these wonderful events that IPI is hosting almost every night. Anyway, and thank you to ICAN, our mother organization, the Global Network of Women Peace Builders, which I represent, is a program of ICAN. One of the instruments by which we hold governments accountable to Resolution 1325 and the six other Women, Peace, and Security resolutions are national action plans. There are now 43 national action plans, going on 44. Iraq just completed its national action plan. And while the Global Network of Women Peace Builders work actively in facilitating civil society involvement in national action planning processes, we're also one of the first ones to say it has to adopt an approach that is not just a checklist approach. Meaning they tick it off their responsibility to their international commitments, and they forget about implementation. But then there are also a couple of experiences in Nepal and the Philippines specifically, where a national action plan has become an organizing and mobilizing instrument for women, for grassroots women. And it has institutionalized women's participation in peace processes. In May, the League of Arab States had a meeting in Cairo and adopted a document entitled Protection of Arab Women, which is seen as a document that will push for national action planning in the Arab world. How do you, I can see our sister from Libya already shaking her head. Is there a chance for national action plans in the Middle East and Arab world, or in the MENA region, to work? And if they're going to work, what are the necessary elements that should be assured? Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll start with Saba with the final round of remarks. And a reminder, the questions were thinking about how we do peacemaking in a broader way, what we need from governments who are recognized effective if they can in the Arab region.
سأعود إلى سؤال حول الأخضر الإبراهيمي.
الأخضر إبراهيمي did not directly refuse because he cannot refuse based on the UN resolutions from 1325 to 2122. Emphasized the importance of the participation of women in negotiations, but he said it's difficult because the Syrian process of negotiations was difficult. He found it difficult to bring the government and the opposition together. He also said that the presence of a third delegation on both parties is difficult, which means that the regime will ask for another party, and therefore, and since he wanted to succeed, he said he might not succeed because he was trying to bring the two parties together. And therefore, we are pursuing our pressure to cope and to succeed if Geneva will continue. We don't know when the next meeting will be held. Regarding the culture and traditions and religion on what happens to the child girl in asylum or in refugees, there is early marriage phenomena. There are some women who were forced to work into prostitution. We don't deny that. But the question is it a new phenomenon than early marriage? Is it a phenomenon? Syria has 6 laws for all religions, the Christians and Muslims and Jews. All these rules and laws allow for early marriage. Thus, the law protects early marriage of child's marriage. We have been calling for the age of marriage to be decreed as 18. This was not applied. Therefore, the cultures and traditions and laws allow that. Religion plays a great role in convincing others that the Prophet, peace and praise be upon him, has married a 9-year-old. This is what's happening in our societies. The early marriage, we tell the child who wants to get married, if you want to get married for what? She says, because I want to help my family financially. That you might help them 2 or 3 months, but you will live 60 years paying the price of these 2 months. Your family will go back, will revert to poverty. Learn a profession and we will help you, and you can help your family until you reach the age of 18. And in Lebanon, with a Lebanese organization called Kifa Orphan, we managed to help many, many girls out of such predicaments. There was a question on the first track, the second track, and the third track. This is indeed important. Do we work on the first track as Syrian women? Do we really want only to sit on the negotiating table? Is it a formality, of course? No. The first track, the second track, and the third track are not necessarily contradictory. 4 days ago, some of peace activists tried to call for parties of the pro-regime and the pro-opposition in Austria, Vienna. They invited around 70 people, including women, though a minority, of course, but the supporters of the regime could not come to Vienna because the regime wouldn't allow them. And because some of them are afraid, if they participate, we won't be able to return to the country and could be questioned for sitting with the opposition. The regime remains strong security-wise. There is a girl called Mariam Hay. I was in New York on the first month before the Security Council, who was detained because she works in the Red Cross, only because she works in the Red Cross. She was arrested 4 days ago, and she was shown on Syrian TV, and she was forced to admit that she supports terrorism. So you can imagine what is happening in Syria. I am a terrorist. I'm being pursued by 2 branches of security. I fled my country 1 year ago because I'm a terrorist. Is that, and my friend Laila also is a terrorist. This beautiful lady is a terrorist. All opposition are terrorists. The regime targets the civilians. It targets women. Our women are still in detention center. 1,000 university students was arrested simply because they took part in demonstrations or helped in relief operations. because you are financing the families of terrorists. We therefore, there are some youth organizations that are working, but very modest steps. Supporters still are afraid to sit with us. They are scared of the security. They are scared of the regime, really. Because they are supporters. Though they are supporters, they are scared of sitting with us because this is, this in itself is a charge, an accusation. We have friends who support the regime, and they are part of the Syrian Women's League. It's an old organization that has branches all over. We have supporters, we have those who oppose. We have relations with those who support the regime. I thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. Now, I'm afraid because of time, I think we'll just give remaining panelists 1 to 2 minutes to respond to those questions and say any closing remarks that you'd like to make. Do you want to speak again?
Our friend from Norway put a very important question, very challenging question. I think it's very important. I have to admit to you that we have, at least in Libya and few Arab countries, lots of respect for the Nordic countries. Sweden, Denmark, Norway. These countries have been really systematically positive and helpful and different. I think what we, at least for us in Libya, or not necessarily in Libya, for the whole question of women in peace and security, it would be very important that you in Norway, when, you know, we need the defense minister, the minister of foreign affairs, the minister of finance, the big ministries, the minister of interior, these ministries, when you invite women from other regions, they don't go and meet only with the funding institution or with the woman minister of social affairs. That's finished. We need to be exposed to the parliamentarians, to the big ministers, and for them to see and listen to the new voices that they have never listened to. Secondly, we would like you very much, really, to communicate with your ambassadors in our countries, because our government listens to your ambassadors, and I think we know very well that many ambassadors are interfering in our internal politics, and when we go and tell them, you need to help us as women to be in this and that, they say this is domestic and we cannot push the governments. And the same thing with the United Nations. Oh, we cannot talk to the government, we are hosted by the government and blah, blah, blah. So I think this would be very important. This would be very, very important. And I would like to invite many of you to come to Libya and let us have a big conference, because today the human rights defenders in Libya, the women, are really under severe attack. Maybe in 2, 3, 4 months, many of us might be shot, or many of us will just be again in exile, and I will die in exile. So I think we need to have the visibility of the international community. Yes. And the international presence and the international support. They all went to Rome and they didn't solve nothing. Libya's still in a chaos after 3 years. There, it took a woman, Ana Gomez. She is a parliamentarian who is really handling the Libyan security in the Libyan case in the security in the European Parliament. Ana Gomez made a statement a few months ago, and she said that we have spent 60 million sterling, to protect the Libyan borders, and it was a waste of money, and nothing has happened, which is true. The Libyan borders are not protected, and that's a big challenge. And she said because the British and the French are not very much seriously interested in protecting the borders. They're only interested in signing contracts, business contracts, for the infrastructure. So I think, you know, again, a woman at the European Union. So I think this is what we really are in need in Libya. And I want to repeat, I hope Norway with other Nordic country, we need to create this, my dear friend, the Arab League. What Arab League? The Arab League is half dead, half paralyzed. Uh-huh. They are governments. They have nothing to do with us. So we need to have a strong network of Arab women, new Arab networks for Arab women, scholars, activists, human rights defenders, because we need to connect. We are not connected yet. For 3 years, we have been asking international community to help us to do that. So this is my answer to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. From our perspective, I would just share a few examples. Actually, it's very important for good practice to be recognized and to count on sustainability. It's very important to force and to support something what is sustainable, because our experience shows that internationals really put a lot of money, but on unsustainable projects, and it's waste of money. We had a very good example in our national action plan, especially because we have to have some kind of the legal framework and to make the government accountable. And all the resolution what we mentioned are the good tools, like other convention and declaration. We have to have something in hand. Bosnia and Herzegovina example is that Gender Equality Agency lead the coordination, and the Ministry of Defense and Security, we lead them. They let us to be led by us, and it's really great success. And also under our national plan on 1325, we signed the declaration on cooperation from our regional country, like Serbia, Montenegro, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Macedonia. That's, you know, that the Bosnia was in war with Serbia. But now we signed the declaration on cooperation of institutional mechanisms, and we signed with our sister from Mediterranean country, because we want to exchange experience and to try to help them with our failures, to introduce them where we failed and what should not be done. And of course, to learn from them in moving our processes as well.
Great, thank you. So Sanam, Mickey, if you have...
Wait.
Okay.
Thank you very much. When I started this work about 20 years ago, I was interested in the role of different sectors of society. And we had a conference with women, and there was a Rwandan woman who stood up and spoke about, this was in 1998, she spoke about the need for reconciliation and moving forward. And I discovered she'd lost 100 relatives. And it was 20 years ago. And I, to this day, when I think about it, I think about her and I think about, that's what inspired me to do this work. Because if people like that exist, yeah, we internationally have to support them. They are the future of their countries. Absolutely. And it comes back to the question that we had about peace. Peace can be the absence of war, which is the way the international community has run it. It's, we stop the fighting, we have a ceasefire, you go back to, you know, pull back, we have a demilitarized zone. That's not the reality in Rwanda or Bosnia or Syria or elsewhere. If we just leave it as the absence of war, the war comes back. Absolutely. Because you need to deal with the root causes, right? Yeah. We have to go from a negative peace, yes, to a positive peace. That's a fundamental shift in attitude that we need. And the track one and track two and track three are critical. But the reason why we insist on the track one is because we've seen it over and over. You can have amazing initiatives at track two and track three levels. The guys sit in a smoky room at the track one level, they cut up the piece of pie, they make their deals, and they ruin it for the rest of the population. And that's just not good enough. So that's why those initiatives need to be linked. It's not enough just to be in one place. It's not enough to just be in. You need these processes linked because the wars are in all of these spaces. If the war is in your home, if it's in your family, right? How is it possible that two guys sitting in Geneva are going to solve the problem? It needs to be at every level. And that's just the reality of the 21st century. And if we don't move in this direction, all of it becomes irrelevant. And, yes. And we're
all diving together.
Yes, we're all diving together.
Thank
you. On that happy note.
Join me in thanking these incredible panelists. And thank you for being here this late with us as well.
Thank you.